My name is Sue, and I'm one of the childbirth educators at Holy Redeemer Hospital. Welcome to our childbirth education series. We will be discussing today newborn care. The idea is the more the baby is with you, the less exposure they're getting to others, number one. And number two, if the baby's in the nursery and the baby's not with you, you won't be able to see the baby's hunger cues. So what that looks like is a lot of times the babies will do some lip smacking. They might stuff their hands or their fingers into their mouth. They might be alert and looking around for you, the mom, or you, the partner. They make little sounds. They might cry. And so typically, the attention that's called to the nursery nurse is the fact that the cry means that they're usually hungry. So when we bring them to you, they're crying. And so for many new parents, they think when the baby cries, that's the best time to feed them. In actuality, it's one of those few steps before the crying is when we really prefer to get the baby and the mom together, or the baby and the partner together, whether regarding breastfeeding or bottle feeding. So ideally, we'd like to encourage new parents to have the baby with you as much as possible in the room for your protection as well as the baby's protection. And speaking of safety, we have changed some of our visitation practices. And so, you know, we talked about this previously. When mom goes to triage, as soon as she's evaluated and admitted, that's when her support person can then come to our floor and be with that person for their entire labor, delivery, recovery, and postpartum. As far as postpartum goes, you will not be allowed, as sad as it seems, to have visitors on the floor other than your support person during this time. This is a safety measure that we've had to institute along with all the other hospitals in our community to again prevent infection and disease to get to you, to get to your partner, to get to your baby. The less contact they have with people, the better off your new baby is, and hopefully will prevent COVID-19 virus from being transmitted from person to person to the baby as well too. So at this time, the only visitor that you may have is your support person. At the time of delivery, that person will be given a band. That band will match your band, mom, and baby will be given two bands. Same identical number on all four bands. Baby has two, mom has one, partner has the other. That band needs to stay on mom and dad's arms until the baby is discharged to your care. It's your admission into the hospital. Once they see your band at our security checkpoints for temperature and screening for disease, they will do the screening and allow that support person to move on up, you know, to the maternity area, which is located on the fourth floor. So we have other safety measures in place for our newborn babies as well too. So at the time of delivery, in addition to their identification band, two of them, one on each ankle, the baby will also receive an infant abduction transmitter that we also place on the baby's ankle. It's a square box. It prevents anybody who's unauthorized to remove the baby from our locked unit, which is another safety measure that we have. So I know this sounds very strict, but we're very serious about the safety of your child. And we have never had a baby abducted from our hospital, and we don't intend to have one abducted with these safety protocols that we have in place. As you can see, I'm wearing a specific color scrubs. All of the nurses have the same color. The PCAs, our nursing assistants, have a different color. And as you can also see, I have my identification badge here with me, and a green stripe. The green stripe signifies that I'm permitted to work on my unit that has babies, and that I can transport babies as well. So these are some safety measures. We also have video cameras strategically placed on our unit at all the entranceways and in the hallways. So we have many safety measures in place. Security can view any of the cameras at any time. All of our video is recorded. And we make sure that we identify the baby. Every time you and baby are separated, we bring back from the nursery a baby to you before you get to touch the baby. In the baby's crib, we look at the identification number on the band, and we ask you to check yours to make sure that the numbers are a match. So again, we use the crib card to give us a clue where who might go with who, and then we use the identification band to be certain before the baby is removed from the crib and placed into either support person or mom's arms. We also, again, encourage rooming in as a way to minimize contact with other people and keep the baby safe with you as much as possible. So these are our safety measures that we've got implemented at Holy Redeemer, and they're really important to us, and we're very inflexible about it, to be honest, because it's your safety and it's your baby's safety, and so we should be. You'll be asked to wear masks when the nurse enters the room to protect the nurses as well as to protect yourself and the baby. We have strict hand washing protocol that we follow. We Purell in and out of every patient's rooms. We Purell and wash our hands in between our baby's care. We only transport one baby at a time to one room at a time. The baby can only be transported in a crib, never in someone's arms. We expect you, if you'd like to walk the floor, that's perfectly fine. Baby cannot be left alone or unattended at any time. So the baby goes back to the nursery for your walk, or you take the baby with you on your walk in their crib, in their protected crib. Nobody ever runs down the hallway with a baby in a crib. So we always are careful where our feet go and that our babies are well protected at all times. Again, our nursery is locked, and it's a locked nursery within a locked unit for postpartum. So that's important for you to understand too. While you're in the hospital, we again will provide all the clothing that the baby needs, all the diapers, all the wipes, all the food if your baby is formula feeding. You would have to provide the food if mom chooses to breastfeed. However, at the time of discharge, it's the expectation that you will bring your own blankets, your own clothing for the baby. We won't provide you for blankets, and we won't provide clothing. Anything that's in the baby's crib that's not linens is yours to take home. So if there's extra diapers left in the baby's crib, they're only good for that baby, you take them home. The baby's crib card can be removed as a souvenir as well. One of the baby's identification braces will remain on the baby's ankle, and you can take that off when you get home, and that can be part of your souvenir as well too. We don't remove the transmitter for the baby for infant abduction safety until the time of the baby is ready to go, and we have a car seat either on the floor or in the support person's car. With regards to education and support, we give a ton of education. We try our darndest to role model all of it. So it's no good if we continue to do the care for your baby and you've never changed a diaper when you leave the hospital. So we typically show you one and make you do one. We show something, we do something. So we change the baby for you, we make you do it the next time. If you don't know how to put clothing on your baby, no problem. We'll show you how to do it. We'll take it off. We'll give the jacket to you. Now you put it on. So it's a lot of see one, do one. Again, if you're vaginal delivery, we have 48 hours to teach you everything you need to know in a very short amount of time. So between you and your support person, hopefully some of this stuff sticks. The more involved you are, the more eager to learn, the more we can teach you, so it's really important that we engage you in the process as soon as you're able to, as soon as you've got a little bit of rest and food into you, that you start doing the care for yourself and for your baby as well. We do a lot of screening for your baby. Some of it is state mandated, and we give medications as well that are state mandated too. So two state mandated medications we must give to your baby within 2 hours of life are vitamin K and erythromycin ointment. So erythromycin ophthalmic ointment is given to your baby to prevent blindness, as well as vitamin K, which will help prevent bleeding in the newborn. So there are two medications that if you decide you do not want to have, you need to tell us before we give medication. So we're required by the state to give it. We don't get a choice. We also do metabolic screening about 24 hours after delivery, so that test must be done prior to your discharge. At this time, people are requesting a minimum amount of stay in the hospital. So if you are healthy and well, and the baby is healthy and well, after 24 hours, if the baby's pediatrician says it's okay, then they'll go ahead and do a discharge if you have a follow-up appointment scheduled with your pediatrician. So the idea is you have to have that follow-up appointment usually within a few days of discharge. And if there's a concern or an issue that's outstanding, the doctor will make you make that appointment the next day after discharge. So if you're leaving on Monday, you have to have a follow-up appointment on Tuesday with your own pediatrician to check up on things. Metabolic screening is done at the 24-hour mark. At our own expense, we do over 30 tests. We're only mandated by the state to do about 10. We here at our hospital do over 30 metabolic screening tests. We get a sample of blood from your baby's foot. We have to send this off to the state laboratory. They screen the blood and they see if the baby has any of these metabolic diseases. If they do, we will contact your pediatrician. The pediatrician will then contact you, and then they'll let you know what the disease is, what it means, and what needs to be done to help your baby as soon as possible. We get the results typically within a week to 10 days after your discharge from the hospital. So by the time you go back for your first to second visit with the doctor, they should have these results and be able to discuss them with you. We also do hearing screening, which is typically done about the 24-hour mark as well. So we screen every baby who's born here at Holy Redeemer, which is state mandated as well, to make sure that each baby can hear. Some babies don't pass that test because they still have a fair amount of fluid in their ear, and we will reschedule the test again. So if you're doing a short stay, you would have to come back to have the hearing screen test repeated. If you're here and we do the test twice, they'll refer you to someone on the outside who can check the baby's hearing and continue to follow up with you. With regards to feeding, we hope and recommend and really work hard to have you feed your baby about every 2 to 4 hours. If you're a breastfeeding mom, 2 to 3 is preferred. If you're formula feeding, 3 to 4 is preferred. We'll provide all the formula you need here in the hospital. Hopefully you'll provide all the breast milk your baby will need. We also have a breastfeeding class that I highly recommend if you're choosing to breastfeed your baby that you view as well. It will tell you a lot of information about when your milk comes in, how to hold your baby, how to get your baby to latch to your breast, how do you know your baby is getting enough food. For all of our babies, typically, we are expecting the baby to have one stool a day, at least one. They can have more, but just one stool a day, and at least 1 to 2 wet diapers a day, minimum. But ideally, the baby should have a wet diaper every other diaper change for baby's formula and or breastfeeding. In the hospital, we use blankets. We highly recommend that you actually don't use blankets when you get home, that you use a jacket, either zip up or snaps, to put the baby in the crib with versus a blanket. By the time the baby's about 3 months old, they can roll over. Up to that point, they do a lot of scooching in the crib. And your cribs are much bigger than our cribs here. We have a very small crib that's about the size of the baby. Your cribs are much larger. So even a baby who's swaddled, and that's that special wrap, and we'll show you how to do that when you get here. That special wrap that the baby seemed nice and content, it reminds them of the womb. It keeps them nice and safe. When they stretch, they know where their boundaries are, much like when they stretched in the uterus of mom. So the swaddle is the preferred thing that we normally do for the first week after delivery. After that, again, a zip up or a snap jacket kind of a thing, so that the baby doesn't have the blanket all over the crib and then potentially puts the blanket over their head and can suffocate. If you've had a baby boy, you have to decide whether you're going to circumcise or not circumcise. It's usually your personal preference. There is no medical reason for a baby boy to be circumcised. However, culturally or religious preference tends to guide what people do. And so you can have that discussion with either obstetrician or pediatrician for more information. Please know that it's the obstetrician that performs circumcision here at Holy Redeemer. And your nurse will keep the baby in the nursery for observation for approximately half hour after the procedure. And then we will show you specifically what the circumcision looks like and how to care for it when you come to hospital. It's important to remember when to call the pediatrician. And I usually find new parents will call then rather than not call, which is a good rule of thumb to follow. Specifically, if the baby's having difficulty breathing or has changed color, that's a call to the pediatrician or 911, either one, whichever, you know, seems like a better choice. If the baby has had no output in 24 hours, if the baby hasn't eaten in 12 hours, you need to call the pediatrician as well too. Any change in the baby's alertness or any changes of concern to you, please call the doctor. As a rule of thumb, most pediatricians will answer any calls from moms or dads all day long and into the evening. They seem to be a little less available because you have to go through a call system. you know, for the off-shift hours. So my rule of thumb to you, my personal tip to you is if you have a concern about your baby that you've been watching for several hours and it's day or evening hours, just go ahead and call the pediatrician. Call them, find the answer to your question, and either get a good night's sleep or know that we have a problem, we have to get medication, or we have a problem, we have to go to the ER. So don't sit on something that you've been stewing about for a few hours. Just call the pediatrician, ask your question, and get the answer so that you can feel okay and not be anxious about it. Additionally, we will ask you whether you have a pediatrician chosen. It's preferred that you have one prior to coming to the hospital, somebody you've eyeballed up in the community that you're comfortable with. Many of the pediatricians will have a conversation with you over the phone or Zoom, something like that, so that you can talk to them, meet somebody from the practice, and ask questions. One of the most important questions I really feel that you should ask your pediatrician is who do I call when I have a problem? How available are you? What do I do when I have a problem? Is it hard to get into your office, or do I have to wait? The pediatrician that I've used for my daughter, it doesn't matter. She's going on 18 now. She was a newborn. She's 18 years. If I've got a problem, I call my pediatrician and they say, when can you come? That's what they say. When can you come? And that has given me great comfort as a new mom, as an experienced old mom, and any mom in between that I was, to know that I just had to call and my pediatrician was ready to see my child as soon as I could get her to the office. And that would give you some peace of mind as well too. So think of some questions you'd like to ask a pediatrician. And don't just choose one practice, you can choose to interview a few if you would like to just see, you know, what it's like to be there, or what the doctor's philosophies are about childcare in general. You will be asked to make some decisions about vaccines. We do give vaccine right away in the hospital. The vaccine that we give within 24 hours is hepatitis B. It's still one of the most contagious diseases, and so we choose to vaccinate just like all the other hospitals in our area with hepatitis B as the very first vaccine the baby gets in the hospital. It's a series of three, so baby will still need two more vaccines, and in general, we'll need lots of vaccines. So if you're opposed to vaccines or you have concerns about vaccines, the time to ask is ask that pediatrician before you even deliver your baby. What's their view on vaccines? What's your view on vaccines? You know, some practices feel very strongly babies should have vaccine. So just be clear about what their philosophy is and practice, and make sure it jives with yours. Thank you so much for choosing Holy Redeemer Hospital, and we hope to see you sometime in the near future. Thank you.